Have you seen the land living by the breeze? Can you understand the light among the trees? Tell me all that you may know. Show me what you have to show. Tell us all today, if you know the way to blue.
I don't think he wanted to be a star, but I think he had this feeling that he'd got something to say to the people of his own generation. He had a feeling that he could make them happier, and he didn't feel that he did that.
It's great that people are discovering Nick. Once you discover Nick, you're going to tell other people.
If you met a girl and you took her back to her room, and if there was some Nick Drake records there, you were probably going to want to marry her.
I feel sort of a bit of infinity with him. I think of like Nick, and it makes me think of home.
I think that one of his great tragedies, I think he said to someone, I've got no more songs.
There were moments when it was very sad working with Nick. Later on.
Well, I came to Nick Drake's music very late, and just, you know, it's got some sort of magical quality, which, you know, is kind of, there's a lot of sort of mysticism, not mystique attached to Nick Drake, because he only made three records and not much known about him. There's no film of him, like we said earlier on, very little recorded word. So, but there's still a kind of magic about his music, I think, and it's sort of got that kind of fragility, which a lot of people identify with, I think.
My parents were both wonderful. They had an idyllic early marriage out in Burma because life was wonderful for colonials at that time. We were very typical, I suppose, of a certain class, upper middle class. My father, as a young man, had gone out east and was an engineer. My mother was very much Nick's mother. She was very beautiful and she was very creative. And I think, really, would have been a troubled soul if it hadn't been for having married my father. My father made living possible for my mother. But it did not destroy her creative ability either. She flourished as a songwriter. We came back to England. Nicky was four. And our very, very earliest school was together. And I always remember, I remember Nick's first day at school, and I was by that time head girl of this school, and I remember being absolutely beastly to him, and him coming running into my classroom for a bit of comfort, I think, and I almost sort of denied the fact that he was my brother. And it was something I felt so deeply ashamed of afterwards, and I put it to him, of course he'd completely forgotten about it in later years, but I never forgot it.
He was captain of various games and things when he was at his first school, and when he went to his next school he became head boy of his first house. But it didn't really seem to mean very much to him. The headmaster said, gave him a very good report, but said at the end, we none of us seemed to know him very well. And I think that was it all the way through with Nick. People didn't know him very much.
And as I said, my mother and my father were both composing songs from my earliest youth. I remember it happening, particularly my mother, who wrote songs about both of us from my earliest childhood. And I think that Nick was unconsciously very influenced by her. He may be horrified at the time to have heard this, but I'm quite certain that he was very influenced by her whole chord structure and by her way of composing. And perhaps the best way of showing this is to actually play one of her songs, and you can see somewhere the similarity and the influence.
I met Nick Drake when I was here in Cambridge, and he was up in Fitzwilliam College reading English. There was an element, I think, of us feeling slightly superior to other students who were cycling to lectures on their bicycles. We would sort of get up late, we would smoke dope, we would not go to lectures. I think we felt we were a little bit sort of superior. And I was the guy who smoked more dope than anybody else, and I'm the guy who went on and had drug problems sort of later on. But there was this, it was really a three-year holiday, and Nick would go off and he would just play his guitar. I mean, I'd sometimes go and see him up in Fitzwilliam, and he would just be playing the same riff over and over again, and he always made it look effortless. I was always very struck by his guitar playing, because I would sort of strum Beatles songs or something, but he was playing this folky, bluesy style that was always very clean and with great precision, and he could repeat it over and over again and just go on and on for hours playing this amazing riff with, you know, interesting finger picking and stuff. It just amazed me. I mean, we never actually did a whole lot.
I can show you, I can read you a bit. Where is it? There's another bit here. I have to say that I'm afraid this letter got eaten by mice in the drawer where it was kept. So there are bits that are missing, but not too badly. Yes, here we are. It may surprise you to hear that during the last few weeks I've been extraordinarily happy with life, and I haven't a clue why. It seems that Cambridge can in fact do rather nice things to one if one lets it, and I'm not sure that I did let it before. I think I've thrown off one or two rather useless and restrictive complexes that I picked up before coming here. The work isn't too bad at the moment. I'm doing sort of 17th and 18th century poets, people like Swift, Pope, Blake, etc., who have quite a lot to offer in their way, but they seem to be very difficult to write about. Must stop now and go to bed.
Better said she prayed today for the sky to blow away, or maybe stay. She wasn't sure. For when she thought of summer rain calling for her mind again, she lost the pain.
I've lost the ceiling.
Gonna see the river man, gonna tell him all I can about the band. Feeling free. If he tells me all he knows about the way his river flows, don't suppose it's meant for me. Oh, how they come and go. Oh,
both of us, we were very keen on him staying at Cambridge. You know, whatever else you did in life, if you managed to get a degree, at least you'd have something to fall back on. His reply to that was that a safety net was the one thing he did not want. So that rather cut the ground from under my feet. Yeah.